She's back! Welcome to the Mean Lady Talking Podcast, the tough-talking, advice-giving, butt-kicking show for the 2020s by the not-really-mean, mean lady, Susan J. Elliott.
Good day, everybody. This is Susan Elliott, host of Mean Lady Talking Podcast, and welcome to a special edition of Mean Lady Talking Podcast. We are kicking off season 3 with a special 3-part episode 100. This is 100C, where we're going to talk about grief. Now, grief is the thing that sets GPYB apart from most other breakup books, even though some talk about it and some talk about it in a very casual way, or they refer to Elizabeth Kubler-Ross's 5 stages of grief, which is completely wrong and doesn't really apply well to this, and I'll get into that. But because we are talking about the definitive Chris Watts for part of this first bit of season 3, I want to talk about grief and the legal system as part of this episode as well. That is what I did my legal thesis on. I've talked a lot of times about the fact that I did all 3 of my honors thesis, undergrad, graduate, and law, on grief. People have said to me, how in the world did you do your legal thesis on grief? And that's something that I'm going to talk about at the beginning here, and then I'm going to go into how we apply grief to breakups. When Elizabeth Kubler-Ross came out with Death and Dying in the 1970s, she did not know that people were going to hijack the very work that she did with terminally ill patients to slap it onto absolutely everything, which is what they've done. And it really has misinformed everybody about what the grief process is and what it looks like and how it's supposed to go. We're very, very bad as a society in Western culture about how we deal with loss and grief. We don't deal with it. We don't teach people how to do it. And as a result, people have a loss and they fall apart, and they think that all of their falling apart has to do with that particular loss. They don't realize that they have a mountain of unresolved grief and that they're falling apart over this loss isn't really just about this loss. It's about all of the things you've never really grieved. And people haven't grieved because they're being told so many different things that are designed to not grieve. After a breakup, there's other fish in the sea. Don't waste your tears on that person. Go find someone else. You'll feel better. And it's all designed for us to shut down our grief. And we hear this from well-meaning friends and family because they don't know how to deal with their grief. That is why they give us this horrible advice. Or if you ever started crying and somebody comes over to hug you, the effect is usually you stop crying because you want them to think that their hug has had some sort of effect. But what they could do instead is to sit there in empathic silence and let you know by their body language that they're there for you, that they're listening, that they care. And maybe when you finish crying on your own, not in response to a hug, they can say, do you want a hug? And right now we're in the middle of a pandemic. I don't know how people are listening to this before or after when things get back to normal, but that's why I'm putting this stuff here. So if we're still in the pandemic, don't go around hugging people anyway. So it's a good thing. Let people cry. And if somebody's had a loss, if somebody's had a death, the best thing you can do is ask them to tell you about the person. People want to talk about the person that they lost. People want to hear about it. I know that I lost my husband years ago, but he was the best person I've ever known. He was the most loving, caring individual. He was happy-go-lucky. He was somebody I would want in my life, even if we weren't married, because he just had such a positive effect on me. And he cared so much about the people in his life. And I remember one time I was driving somewhere with one of my kids, and I mentioned something that was, you know, kind of a sad memory or something that he would have liked. And my son said, happy times, Mom, happy times. Like, you know, like, shut up about this. And I've done videos on YouTube, and you can check them out on the YouTube channel. I have one on widows and widowers, and it's like, that's what people want. They want us to be happy. They want us to not talk about it. They want us to not be feeling the feelings many years after things have passed. If they haven't had our relationship with our partner, they don't understand, and they're never going to understand. But the goal of most people, whether it's a breakup or you lost your pet or your parent died or you lost your job, whatever it is, the message coming in is almost always, don't grieve, don't grieve, don't grieve, don't grieve. And that is the thing that this program and this podcast and my books and my groups try to fix. We've got to fix this. It's just terrible. I mean, it is an epidemic of horrible proportions that we don't know how to deal with our grief. And then we run from bad relationship to bad relationship to bad relationship, trying to not feel as bad as we really feel. And that is the problem. Now, when I did my legal thesis, it was called Pain and Grief, the Legal System's Responsibility Toward Victims of Crime. And pain was spelled P-A-Y-N-E because the case that I was talking about is a horrible case called Pain v. Tennessee that went to the Supreme Court. In Pain v. Tennessee, what happened was Pain had murdered his ex-girlfriend and her daughter, and he stabbed her son. And in the victim impact statements, her mother testified the impact that her death had on his son, on her son, and the rest of the family. And prior to Pain, there were other cases that didn't allow such broad victim impact statements. And the Pain decision basically overruled them. So Pain said that in calling for the death penalty, the prosecution could not use the impact of the death on the victim's family, that was going beyond what the criminal statutes against murder foresee. So he's basically saying, if she did not have a five-year-old son, if she did not have a young son, if she did not have a mother, if she didn't have anybody come into court, would the prosecution still be calling for the death penalty? And the Supreme Court said that was fine, and it was fine. And it was seen as the broadening of victim impact statements and of victims really becoming front and center in the criminal justice system. Now, my argument in my legal thesis was that that's not where victims belong. There was a murder case where a man was sentenced for life for murdering his girlfriend's parents. And you might have heard of the case, and the defendant's name was Jan Soring. He was a German student at the time who was here going to school in the United States. And he was paroled last year, and it was very surprising to a lot of people. There had been a groundswell of support for him, and people thought that he was innocent. It's a very interesting case and a very interesting question as to whether or not he was innocent. But there was a documentary that I saw where he was interviewed when he was in jail, and he said that the justice system is designed to balance the needs of the victim, the defendant, and state. And like, that's so true. And in many years, and Jan Soring made this point in this documentary, the victim's family have become more and more inserted into the process. And while I get that as a lawyer, I also know, not only from the criminal case, but from the divorce side of things and the custody battles that I've been involved in and the restraining orders that I've been involved in and all the things that are less than a murder, the justice system, the legal system does a horrible job of really dealing with victims and their issues. And there's some sort of hope that if we get this murderer to the death penalty, or we execute them, or we do whatever you want us to do, you're going to have closure. And many years, these cases go on and on and on. It did not in the Watts case. There was 3 months between the murder and the plea deal, which was incredibly fast. Normally, victim families are waiting around for years and years and years waiting for something to happen. And then is the appeal process. I mean, if you look at the Jodi Arias case, her appeal was just denied this year. His family goes through going on with that nut case all the time. The other thing is that the legal system continues to put forward this idea that your closure comes from other people, places, and circumstances, and it does not. As it says in Getting Past Your Breakup and in all of my materials, closure comes from inside you. It's this whole idea that we can get closure from someone else doing something else that leads us to insist upon final conversations with our ex. I'm looking for my closure. Where's my closure? Give me my closure. They do not need to give you your closure. You need to get your closure. You need to find the closure inside you. And that's the whole thing about closure. And that's one of the reasons that I have big problems with the legal system and the way that they deal with victims' families. And I've been a person in a victim family. My son was brutally assaulted in 2002. And we went through the victim's advocate office and we dealt with things. And the kid was the son of a diplomat from Turkey, and he could go back any minute. And we were dealing with, oh my God, like, we're not going to get justice on this. And we had to find a way to deal with it and move on. So I've been in the victim family role, and I've been in there with clients of mine as an attorney, and I've been in there with clients of mine as a therapist. I know what it's like, and I've been in the legal system for a very long time, both as a therapist and a lawyer and a divorce coach. And I've been on legal teams, and I've been on teams that clients have put together when they're fighting custody or parental alienation and all of these very serious, serious issues. And I see up close and personal how the legal system just doesn't do the job, because it can't. Nobody's in there teaching them these things. Nobody. I went to law school. I've spent a lot of years in court. I spent years in court before I ever went to law school. I know the drill. The legal system is completely incapable of helping people with closure and dealing with their grief. So that is what I argued in my legal thesis, that this is not the place, and we should not be leading victim families into believing that at the end of the day, they're going to have some sort of comfort and closure that they don't find. And you can hear it over and over and over again. If you're a true fan aficionado, which I have a lot of listeners who are, you know that many times if you watch a program and they're talking to victim families the whole time, after the verdict, which goes in their favor, which is the one that they wanted, they'll ask them, is this better? Well, it doesn't bring them back, is usually what they say. And in the divorce realm, it can be even worse than that. Because people walk out of court after being told by a lawyer, well, just give up this, this, and this, and you'll feel better because it'll be over and you'll have your closure. And they give things up and they walk out and they still feel as stunned and crazy as they did the day that they started. It seems like there is this promise of closure, of having something that you just don't get from the legal system when you go through this process. And I just argue that we shouldn't be leading people into believing that, because the legal system is completely incapable of delivering this. Now, Getting Past Your Breakup was one of the first books on breakups to acknowledge the grief process. And I'm very disappointed in books that have been published since this book that just go back to the Elizabeth Kubler-Ross thing. Grief does not happen in stages. Stages seems to suggest that you go neatly from one stage to the other, and I'm done with that, and then I go on. And then when people find themselves back in a previous quote-unquote stage, they're shocked, and they're surprised. They don't know how they got there. Wait, I thought I was finished with that stage. We really go through grief in phases, and we can go from one phase to the other and then back to the other phase. So it doesn't happen neatly in stages. And somebody sent me a book that was just published in the past year or so on breakup. And they did the Elizabeth Kubler-Ross thing. And I was like, I can't even believe this. Like, my book is a leading book on breakup, and it's obvious this person never even opened it. I don't know why. Because you shouldn't be talking about grief if you haven't read my book. And when we have a breakup and we have a loss and we haven't grieved all these other things that have happened in our life, and it's not just about other breakups. It's about any breakups, any deaths, any changes that we didn't want, any medical scares we might have had, any medical scares that people near us might have had, any traumatic things that we might have gone through. All those things need to be acknowledged and grieved and let go of. before we can heal. And if we haven't done that work, and most of us haven't because we don't know how, nobody ever told us how, and that's what I'm here for, to tell you how, we just go on with a pile of unresolved grief that just gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And I talk about in Getting Past Your Breakup in my story, which is the beginning of the book. And the whole book isn't my story. Just the beginning is just to show you, like, if I got through this and I did this, you can do it. But after throwing out an abusive, cheating husband, I fell apart. I fell apart like 10 days later. I fell apart completely. And it wasn't about my husband. It wasn't about wanting an abusive, cheating guy back. It was about all the things I'd never dealt with, all the losses I'd never acknowledged. It was about being in foster care. It was about losing my brother. It was about being adopted into an abusive alcoholic home. It was about feeling like I was the only person on earth who was all by themselves. It had nothing to do with my husband, but it took me 10 years in therapy to figure all that out. And I don't mean that it took me 10 years to go, oh, this was about more than that, but it took a few years. And it took at least 10 years to work through a lot of those losses. And I had other losses along the way in those 10 years. You know, I did have to deal with the end of my marriage. I did have to deal with going out and dating again. I never dated. I've been with my ex since high school. And then there were breakups of, you know, small relationships, bigger relationships, serious relationships. And I had to learn how to deal with all of that. And the thing is that grief is hard. It's hard. It's hard. It's hard. And we need to do a lot of self care. Getting past your breakup is about working out the bad and working in the good. You got to balance it. If you don't balance it, you're not going to complete your grief work because it's going to be too hard. You have to stop. In the workbook, I talk about giving yourself permission for a crying session, for an anger session, and then zipping it up and doing a self-care session. That's the only way you get through this. If you haven't seen this in the workbook, you need to go there and you need to see the information about doing a crying session, doing an anger session, and zipping it all up and taking care of you. Most of the time, what we're crying about is not what we're crying about. What we're angry about is not what we're angry about. It's so many other things. We need to journal every day. We need to be doing our affirmations. We need to be doing our self-care. We need to help our psyche along this process of grief. Freud said that grief is the bit-by-bit process of letting go. And it's a painful bit-by-bit process of letting go. And one of the things that happened for me has become a big part of the Getting Past Your Breakup program is I was sitting in the library one night reading about John Bowlby. I've been doing attachment work since 1993. And I want to write a book on it because I think that most books on attachment that are out now are complete crap and that they completely generalize just like people do with grief. They're getting it wrong. They're just getting it wrong. So I was sitting in the library reading John Bowlby, and you can check out the John Bowlby's in my bibliography long before a lot of these pop psychology attachment books came along. And I've been a disciple of John Bowlby and Mary Ainsworth a very long time. And I was reading something on Colin Murray Parks, who is the author of a book called Bereavement, and he did a study on widows. And Colin Murray Parks studied Conlan Lorenz, who does work with animals. And Conrad Lorenz studied the gray lag goose. And the gray lag goose mates for life. And when the goose, his partner, is killed or dies, or the goose goes frantic. The goose could fly hundreds of miles looking for their partner. They intellectually don't understand that the partner is not coming back. Its mind, you know, the mind of a goose, is trying to put the world back the way it knows it to be, which is, I want my partner back. I want the person that I've been with since I was a little gosling. That's what is missing in my world. My world doesn't look right without my partner. We've been together 24/7. People that think that they've had togetherness in their relationship, that you cannot compete with a goose. I mean, the geese are just never, ever apart. They're always, always together. And now this poor goose is on its own. And it flies great distances, often at its own peril. It often gets maimed, hurt, and killed, looking for their partner, because it wants to put the world back the way that it knows it to be. And this is called the searching mechanism of grief. And Colin Murray Parks used this to explain how widows would be scanning crowds looking for their husbands' faces, even though they knew that they were dead. And I did this after my husband died. He used to fish on this little pond, and I used to pass the pond on my way to work. And for months after he passed away, I would look over at the pond to see if he was there. There's the thing about calling somebody, even though you know that they're dead. And I did this with my mother, and I did it with my husband, Michael. I called my husband, Michael's voicemail for 9 months. For 9 months, it took me over a year to turn his phone off because I didn't know if I wanted to live without that voicemail, without that ability to leave him a voicemail. And of course, I never left him a voicemail, but oh boy, was I tempted to. But this is the searching mechanism. It's about the mind's wanting to put the world back the way it knows it. That's what the mind is doing. When you want to contact your ex. That's what it is. It's a searching mechanism. If your ex was not alive, you couldn't do it. You would want to do it, but you couldn't do it. If you and your ex were still together during the happy days, he or she just keeled over, you would still have the searching mechanism. You would still have that drive to want to contact him or her after their death. But when they're alive, it's so tempting. It's so inviting. And with technology now, we can do passive contact. We can look at their social media. We can continue to feed the mind what it wants, which is the reordering of our reality. But that's why no contact is so important. We need to go through the snapping of that reality. We need to get used to a new world where our partner is not there, as painful as it is. But going no contact is like going cold turkey. It feels truly awful for the first few days, but you feel better and better because it's the healthy thing to do. The searching article is on the Getting Past Your Breakup website, and I will drop a link to it in the YouTube video version of this podcast. Please let me know if you have questions about it, because the searching component of grief is something that no one else ever talks about. No one else ever talks about. And it's one of the reasons why Getting Past Your Breakup has been so successful, because we do plug those holes in people's process. The grief process is hard. The breakup process is hard. And before Getting Past Your Breakup, most people never talked about it, never talked about grief even being part of the breakup process. They thought that it was just for people who have died, and it's not. And it's very, very important for you to acknowledge that there has been a loss, and there have been secondary losses. Your hopes, your dreams, maybe your ex's family, maybe mutual friends, maybe things you did together, maybe music you enjoyed together, maybe movies you've seen together. Dealing with any of that stuff is very painful for you, and you have to give it up now. Those are secondary losses, and they must be acknowledged and grieved. And most places and most people and most therapists don't even tell you that. It makes a very challenging, difficult time even harder. It's not okay. One of the things that people don't understand is recycling in breakup grief. C.S. Lewis said, "Grief is a spiral, but am I going up or coming down?" And that's what it feels like. What is going on here? I can't even begin to understand it. And it's very, very important that we begin to understand it. When we understand it, we do better with it. We're going along. We think we're doing okay. We're like, wow, I'm out of the weeds. I'm out of the woods. You remember the nights where all you did was cry. You walked the floor. You cried. You might be angry. You might pound the pillow. Getting Past Your Breakup recommends journaling. Maybe you've been screaming into your journaling for 3 months. And finally, you feel like, oh, I don't have to scream today. I don't have to cry today. I actually feel pretty good today. And you go along, you're like, oh, wow. Like, I think this is working. I think I'm out of it. And then you wake up one day, you're a mess, you're crying, you have no idea why, you don't know if you were dreaming about the ex, you don't know what is happening. Or maybe there was some contact, maybe the ex did get in touch with you, maybe it's their birthday, or maybe something random thing happened, and all of a sudden you're a mess again. That is called recycling and breakup grief, and it's normal, and it's natural, and it's to be expected. We should not be surprised by these things. We should be taught these things from little kids. That is why I tell parents to model healthy breakups to their children. Let them know about grief. Let them know about how a breakup feels. And let them know that you need to be no contact, even if it's with their parent. With children, we do modified no contact, where it's brief, businesslike, and only when necessary. When I say necessary, I mean like the house is on fire necessary, not like I think I need diapers necessary. You have to be honest with yourself when it comes to co-parenting. You really don't need to talk to your ex about all these things about your kids. I virtually raised my kids by myself without any input from my ex, and I did quite fine. And I learned that in the very beginning, he would want to be there for school and want to be there for this and that. But when I stopped interacting with him, when my therapist made me stop talking to him at school things and school meetings, and I didn't have to go out with the kids with him, things like that, she freed me up from all that stuff that he wanted to ram down my throat. That would be good in the name of parenting. It's not good. And you can explain to kids that you and mommy or daddy do not have to be buddy-buddy to be good parents to them. You can parent separately. And you don't make punishments go back and forth, and you don't have to agree on punishments and things like that. As soon as I started distancing from my ex, he lost all interest in any kind of school meeting. I did parent-teacher meetings by myself for years and years and years and years. But the first year, he used them just to get in contact with me and just to berate me and harangue me and all kinds of things. Walking back to our cars, he would always be telling me that whatever we came from was my fault. His gaslighting was incredible when we were together. And it wasn't going to stop as long as we were in contact. So I had to put up boundaries. I had to go no contact. And even as we co-parented, I had to go no contact. And I found that when I didn't engage with him, even when we were standing in the same room together or walking out of a building, I mean, I wanted to defend myself. I had spent years defending myself. It was my second nature to defend myself to him. But I would just keep walking. He would say, you know, that's your fault, right? You know, it's because you are too permissive. You're too this, you're too that, whatever. Once I took that attitude with him, once I stopped talking to him, and he would try the manipulation strategies, because that's what gaslighters do. That's what boundary crashers do. They try to get under your skin. They try to up the ante. And that's what he would do. He would say, oh, I guess you're not interested in co-parenting the kids. And I would want to jump at him. But in my head, I would think, okay, you accusing me of all of that stuff that the kids are doing being my fault and my fault alone, that's not co-parenting. That's you gaslighting me, that you blaming me, that you abusing me. And I said all that in my head to not hook into his games, to not get sucked into him upping the ante because I was setting a boundary with him. Like, I'm not talking about this. I'm not talking about this. And then one time, finally, a few months after we had been going through many different boundary situations, he was ragging on me, going on and on and on about something. I don't know what it was. I think I was in the situation because of one of the kids' situations. And he was going on and on and on. And his regular rigmarole about how awful, terrible person I was. And I just turned to him and I said, what you think of me is none of my business. And he looked at me like I slapped him in the face. And he said, oh, you could take your psychology crap and blah, blah. Yeah, what you think of me is none of my business is psychology crap. No. But his gaslighting, his boundary crashing, all that stuff went away. It all went away because I maintained no contact. So you can maintain no contact with your co-parent, and you should. Even if they're not a gaslighter, even if they're not a boundary crasher, you have to model healthy moving on behavior for your children. And these are all the things that we're not taught. And if you go to the Male Stalking podcast that I did, I will talk about people who threaten to kill themselves if you break up with them. And there have been many, many times, and it's not just Travis Alexander and Ryan Poston, who I talk about in the Male Stalking Victims podcast, but there are plenty of other people who fear for their ex's health and well-being, and they wind up getting murdered. And when I do the Emma Walker podcast, I'll talk about that too. So my son was in the eighth grade and I overheard him trying to break up with this girl, and he couldn't break up with her because she was threatening suicide. And I told him to hang up the phone. And when he hung up the phone, I said to him, you are not responsible for keeping her alive. I knew she was manipulating him, and she did this to boys all through high school and after high school. And I said, if she's serious about killing herself, you need to tell her parents. And if you're an adult and somebody is threatening suicide, you need to call their parents, call their family, call 911, but you don't stay with them because they're threatening to kill themselves. You are not responsible, and you could wind up murdered, like Travis Alexander, like Ryan Poston, like Emma Walker. All these people who cared more about their ex And the list is much longer than these three. So I told my son, I sat him down and we had a talk and I said, you are not responsible for keeping her alive. You're a 12-year-old boy. If she can't handle the fact that you're breaking up with her, she has deep psychiatric issues and she needs to see somebody and you need to let her parents know. I said, the next time she talks to you about killing herself, you tell her you're going to her parents. And that's what you need to do to get out of a situation with a manipulative ex. I was not letting my kids go through any of that baloney with relationships. It was my role as a parent to teach them healthy breakup. And that's what I did. You have to be listening to what is going on in your kids' lives and let them know what the healthy thing is. Grieving, no contact, not trying to be friends, not caring about what other people think because you don't want to be friends. Being friends with the ex is a bad idea. If it's ever going to be, it should be much, much later, but not now. You need the time and space to figure out how to be a single person again. It is very, very important that you take that space and don't let anybody manipulate you into why can't we be friends. If the ex wants to be friends, it's because the ex wants you in their life. They don't want to be in a relationship with you, but they want you in their life. They want their cake and eat it too. Too bad, so sad. Tough. Too bad. Go away, go away, go away, go away. I'm not going to be friends with you. I told one ex of mine, my friends don't treat me the way that you did. So kiss off, goodbye. As my late husband Michael used to say, eat shit, bark at the moon, and die. I mean, that's the way that I would feel with any ex who wanted to be friends. And I had an ex that I said he wanted to have some sort of talk, and we had been friends before we ever went out. And I said to him, we can have coffee, but it's just friends. And the only reason that I agreed to it was because we had been friends before we ever went out. And I was hoping we could get back to that. And he said to me, I don't know if I can keep my feelings for you to just friendship. Which was good that he said that. But a lot of exes don't say that, but that's what they mean. And if they're a narcissist, if they have a personality disorder, they just want to hit off the narcissistic crack pipe, which is you as a supply. They just want to know that they can. So whether they're personality disorder or not, the answer has to be no. No, 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 no. We're not having lunch. We're not being friends. We're not doing this dance. No. And if you yourself can't handle the thought of not having them in your life again, just know, not now, maybe later, but not now. Put the maybe later in there. Put it in for your own psyche. Put it in for your ex. Maybe later, not now. If the ex says when is later, I don't know. I'll let you know. Goodbye. Please don't talk to me again. And you don't have to announce that you're going no contact. You just go no contact. And that helps with the grief process. And know that the grief is not all about your ex. It's about all your unresolved losses. Go to getting past your breakup when you're ready. In the workbook, there is a list of how to do the program. On the website, there is a list of how to do the program. If you go to program resources, there's a link at the top of the page and it says how to do the program. And it says when you're ready to do the relationship inventory. And that's the beginning of healing that relationship. And then the life inventory is about healing all of your relationship. And the mother and father inventory is about healing your childhood wound. It's a comprehensive program that deals with everything. And then getting back out there is about getting back out there. But it begins long before you're ready to date. So get the book now. Now get it. And it says that in the workbook. Get the books now because they work together. You cannot figure out what you need in a future relationship until you're going through this relationship. So you need to do what we call the standards and compatibility inventory, which is in getting back out there with the relationship inventory, which is in getting past your breakup. And you do them together. And then you figure out what you want, what you need. But you also figure out that all the losses had is not just about the sex. You need to feel as bad as you really feel, not just about the sex. You need to deal with all your secondary losses, not just about the sex. You can do this. This is a GPYB saying. And the reason you can do it and how I know you can do it is because I've been doing this for 30 years. This is based on my process. And as I was getting better, people were saying to me, how did you do that? How did you do that? Because they saw I was a completely crazed, suicidal, lunatic mess. And not fake suicide, real suicide. Depressed. I was in a depression group for 12 weeks. I was treated for depression with no medication. I struggled really, really hard every single day to not kill myself. That's how severe the grief feelings were. And when people started seeing me getting better and doing better and being better and having better relationships, and finally culminated in a relationship with a man who adored me, who would do anything for me. People were like, how did you do that? What did you do? Tell me. And first I started telling my friends, and then I went to graduate school. I became a therapist, and I started telling my clients, and it works. It absolutely works. But you have to acknowledge your grief. You have to acknowledge your grief. And don't let anybody tell you there's other fish in the sea, because we're not fishing. We are dealing with human emotions and human situations. And don't let anybody tell you don't waste your tears on somebody, because it's not a waste. They're your tears for your process, for your healing. Clarissa Pinkus Estes, who wrote the wonderful book Women Who Run With the Wolves, one of my favorite books of all time, she said, tears are a river that take us someplace. And they are. So let yourself cry. Let yourself have the grief and the anger and the pain. But you can get through this. You can do this. Don't stuff it. Let it out. We're here for you. Tune in to the Mean Lady Talking Podcast, and please leave me comments on the YouTube version of this podcast. I really want to hear from you guys. Please do that. I truly appreciate that. It will help me with the direction for the podcast in season 3. Thanks a lot, guys. Talk to you all soon. Bye-bye.